In an earlier unit, we explained hash functions. A hash function is a function which takes any input value and returns a generally smaller value within a finite range called a hash. Most commonly, a hash function is used like a kind of sieve that says these inputs go into this bucket, these inputs into that bucket, these inputs into that bucket. And most commonly, the intention is for input values to get more or less evenly distributed between buckets. So with a good hash function, generally any hash output is equally likely for any random input. Now, because the set of possible inputs is generally infinite, like say if we allow numbers as input, then well, there are an infinite number of numbers, and because the return value, the hash, is within a finite range, this means that different inputs will produce the same hash. Like say, if you get the hash value 5 when you input the value 73, but then you also get the output hash value 5 when you input the value 929, well then, for that particular hash function, the values 73 and 929 produce a hash collision. Now, what's called a cryptographic hash function is a hash function with special properties, including the property that, given a hash, you cannot, as a matter of practicability, find one or more inputs that produce that hash. Cryptographic functions also have what's called a strong avalanche effect, meaning that any small change to an input data is going to result in a very different hash, one that doesn't seem to bear any relation to the other. So here, for example, if we have two input strings, Sakatumi exclamation mark and Sakatumi question mark, the two cryptographic hashes we get from these inputs are totally different. There's no apparent relationship. They are not even remotely close values. More formally, the desired qualities of a cryptographic hash function are called pre-image resistance, second pre-image resistance, and collision resistance. Pre-image resistance refers to what we first discussed, that given some output hash, it is very, very difficult, in fact, infeasible, to find any input that produces that hash. Second pre-image resistance refers to the property that, if you have both an input and its hash, it is difficult to find some other input that's going to produce that same hash. And then lastly, collision resistance refers to something subtly different, in that we don't have any particular input we want to find a hash for, we just want to find any two inputs that produce the same hash. And that as well is something that should be infeasible to do with a cryptographic hash function. So now the question is, what is a hash function with these properties good for? Well, one very useful application is as a data integrity check. If Nathan wants to send a file from his machine to Kate's machine, and Nathan and Kate want to verify that the file Kate receives is in fact the precise file Nathan intended to send, well then, in addition to sending the file, Nathan runs the file through a cryptographic hash function, gets that hash, and sends it to Kate. And then Kate can run the file she received through the same cryptographic hash function, and when she compares what she gets out of the hash function herself and what Nathan sent her, those two hashes should match. But if Kate's copy of the file doesn't match Nathan's copy bit for bit, then the hash Kate computes won't match the one which Nathan sent her. Now, of course, it is possible that the hash which Nathan sends could get corrupted along the way. Data corruption does happen, and it very well may happen to the cryptographic hash when it is transmitted, just like data corruption can happen to the file itself. However, it is exceedingly unlikely, like more than astronomically unlikely, that both the file and the hash will get corrupted in such a way in transmission that the corrupted file run through the hashing algorithm will match the corrupted transmitted hash. I mean, it is a possibility, but it's so unlikely you might as well be more concerned about getting struck by meteors. It's also possible that the hash might get corrupted, but the file not corrupted, in which case when Kate checks the hash, she's going to get a false negative. The hash she receives isn't going to match the hash which she produces, and so she's going to assume that the file that she received is corrupted, even though in this scenario it's just the hash that got corrupted. Now, such a thing can happen. It's not as likely, of course, though, as the file itself getting corrupted, because the hash is generally much smaller than the file, so there are just fewer bits to get corrupted. And a false negative generally isn't as harmful as a false positive. The false negative means that Kate's going to erroneously tell Nathan that she needs him to resend the file, even though she already has the right file. Now, another concern is that the data of the file and the hash might not just get corrupted in transmission, but actually tampered with by some attacker. If an attacker can perform a man-in-the-middle attack, meaning they can read and intercept the data as it's transmitted, the attacker could erroneously modify the file or send a completely different file and just erroneously send Kate the wrong hash, one which matches the malicious file. So because of such attacks, a cryptographic hash just transmitted along with the file won't protect you from tampering. It's okay to send the file itself through the unsecure channel, assuming either you don't care if anyone else reads your data or if it's encrypted, but the cryptographic hash should be sent through a secure channel. Like, say, if Nathan just wrote down the hash on a piece of paper and then handed it to Kate in person. That would work, though obviously it's less convenient. But however you do it, if the authenticity and integrity of the hash itself can be assured, then when Kate performs the check, when she runs the received file through the algorithm and checks the output against the hash she received, if they match, then she knows for sure that this is the file, bit for bit, which Nathan intended to send to her. Three of the most commonly used cryptographic hashing algorithms are called MD5, SHA-1, and SHA-2. The MD in MD5 stands for Message Digest, and this is the fifth iteration of an algorithm. MD4 was the predecessor, which was shown to be insecure, and so MD5 was developed about in the early 90s. It produces 128-bit hashes, and then the SHA-1 algorithm is so-called because it stands for Secure Hash Algorithm, and it produces 160-bit hashes. And then several years ago, when SHA-1 was shown to have some weaknesses, SHA-2 was introduced, which confusingly is not one single algorithm. That's why there are different variants that produce different sized hashes, including as low as 224, but as high as 512 bits. And obviously the more bits, the more secure, at least in theory. Whether it makes a difference in practice probably depends on what you're doing, really. For most purposes, 256 bits is probably perfectly adequate. Of these three here, MD5, SHA-1, and SHA-2, SHA-2 is the safe choice. It's the most recent standard. MD5 has been shown to have weak collision resistance, which doesn't matter in all applications, but in some applications that's important, so keep that in mind before using MD5. Now, I won't go into the details of any of these algorithms. As you might imagine, it involves a lot of sort of substitution and transposition and arounds, much like in our block ciphers. The difference here that we are reducing arbitrarily sized input down to one small piece of data. An asymmetric or public key encryption algorithm is one which uses two keys to do encryption and decryption rather than just one. These two keys are not just randomly chosen independent of each other. There actually has to be a special mathematical relationship between the keys, so they instead are generated together in a pair by an algorithm. And that algorithm, of course, takes random input, so it doesn't produce the same pairs of keys every single time. The special relationship between the keys is that when we encrypt with an asymmetric algorithm, we encrypt with one of the keys and then decrypt with the other. One is designated as the public key and the other as the private key. When we encrypt with the public key, then the ciphertext can only be decrypted with the corresponding private key. And with some algorithms, it works the other way too. Encryption with the private key can only be decrypted with the public key. The reason one of the keys is called the public key, and the reason this is sometimes called public key encryption, is because this scheme allows us to publicly disclose one of the keys. It's something we can just publish to the world, rather than keep secret. And in fact, in many applications of public key cryptography, that's precisely what we want to do. We want everyone to have our public key. What this allows is two things. If I generate a pair of keys and then publish the public key to the world, anyone with my public key can encrypt something such that only I may decrypt it, because I'm the only one with the corresponding private key. Another application is that with my public key out there and known in the world, I can encrypt something with my private key, which of course anyone in the world could decrypt because everyone has my public key, but this way everyone is assured that the encrypted message is actually from me. Because I, as the only holder of my private key, am the only one who can encrypt something such that it can be decrypted with my public key. It's exceedingly unlikely that you could run any old bits through the decryption cipher with my public key and get out anything resembling coherent data. So if you do get coherent data, that's a very strong assurance that it is something which I encrypted. Now, as we'll go over when we discuss RSA, the most commonly used public key encryption algorithm, asymmetric encryption tends to be significantly less efficient than symmetric encryption. Therefore, the most common use of public key encryption is actually to exchange symmetric encryption keys. The protocol for this works like this. The receiver of the symmetric key, first off, has their own asymmetric key pair, and assume that the receiver's public key is out there in the world where the sender can get at it, like say it resides in some public directory on the internet. So the sender generates the symmetric key they wish to share with the receiver, and they encrypt it using the receiver's public key. They then transmit to the receiver that encrypted message, and the receiver can then decrypt it with their own private key. So now the sender and receiver have a shared secret, this shared symmetric key, which they exchanged over an unsecure channel, like say the internet. There's actually one flaw here though, and that is that the receiver has no guarantee that they haven't been duped by a man-in-the-middle attack, by someone intercepting their encrypted communication, because it's quite possible that that man-in-the-middle intercepted the sender's key, and even though the attacker can't decrypt it, what they can do is prevent it from reaching the receiver, and they can instead send to the receiver a false key, because this interceptor, the attacker, like everyone else, has access to the receiver's public key. So the attacker can generate their own symmetric key, encrypt that with the receiver's public key, and then send it to the receiver. And there on out, the attacker can carry on communication with the receiver in the guise of the sender. To prevent this attack, we complicate our protocol a little bit. First off, both the sender and the receiver have their own asymmetric key pairs with each other's public keys somehow known to each other, like say through a public directory. As before, the sender generates a symmetric key and they encrypt it with the receiver's public key, but before sending it, they also then encrypt it with their own private key. This means the recipient is going to have to first decrypt with the sender's public key and then decrypt with their own private key. This added layer of encryption doesn't keep out eavesdroppers, but it authenticates that the receiver is getting this message from the intended sender. The most widely used public key cryptosystem is called RSA, which stands for Rivest, Shamir, and Edelman, which are the names of the three inventors. The keys used in RSA can be arbitrarily large, and the larger the key, the more difficult the encryption is to crack, but also the longer it takes to do encryption and decryption. And asymmetric encryption and decryption, as I mentioned earlier, does tend to take a lot longer than plain old symmetric encryption. In practice, the keys used with RSA typically fall in the range from 1024 to 4096 bits. And note that these sizes are significantly larger than anything we would use today in symmetric encryption. I won't get into the math of RSA as I barely understand it myself, but in short, the system revolves around the difficulty of factoring large prime numbers. The secret key in RSA is the combination of two large prime numbers, and then the public key is the product of those two primes. Given any large number, it's a difficult mathematical problem to find two prime factors that make up that number, so it is infeasible for someone given the public key to determine in a reasonable amount of time the secret key. Now, because RSA, like all public key encryption systems, is quite slow relative to symmetric encryption, the most common use of RSA is to exchange symmetric keys. Even on a modern system, encrypting and decrypting, say, a large file, would be very slow with a public key system like RSA. We'll end now with a brief discussion of how encryption gets broken. Cryptanalysis refers to the art and science of extracting hidden information from a system. One approach with encryption is to apply mathematical techniques, including differential analysis, integral analysis, linear analysis, related key attacks, and other such techniques. But aside from such sophisticated approaches, the simplest way to go about breaking encryption is a brute force attack, meaning simply trying all the possible keys. But, of course, any decent encryption system uses large enough keys to make this infeasible. Even a smaller key by today's standards, like a 128-bit key, well, 2 to the 128th power is a very, very, very large number. So large, in fact, that given all the computational resources in the world at your disposal, you probably still couldn't search through all of the keys in anything like a reasonable amount of time. I think even the low-end estimates of how long that would take are somewhere in the range of millions of years. So, for encryption systems thought to still be secure, we don't really worry about brute force attacks. For a system with a weakness, however, that means there's some kind of mathematical technique which allows us to cut down on the key space that has to be searched, thereby possibly making brute force attacks feasible. For example, if a technique were discovered to cut down the effective key space we have to search from a 128-bit space down to a 64-bit space, And remember, we're dealing in powers of 2, so that means cutting the key space down in half 64 times. 2 to the 64th power is a much, much smaller number than 2 to the 128th. If an exploit were discovered that cut down the key space from 2 to the 128th to 2 to the 64th, then a brute force attack on the remaining key space becomes feasible. And actually, this is a common thing with mathematical techniques. They don't necessarily discover the one true answer directly. They rather simply cut down the size of the key space that has to be searched. And then a brute force attack on the remaining key space is what finds the actual key. Cryptanalysis doesn't have to limit itself to only dealing with the ciphertext. There are other ways of getting at hidden information, what are called man-in-the-middle attacks and side-channel attacks. A man-in-the-middle attack refers to any situation where the attacker intercepts data as it's being transmitted. This can mean more than just listening into the communication, but actually interfering. The attacker replaces data being sent with its own data, such that one or both of the communicating parties gets data from the attacker in place of data from their correspondent. By doing so, the attacker might fool one of the two correspondents to send them sensitive data, or the attacker might inject malicious data, and maybe even infect the targets with malware. A side-channel attack exploits the fact that cryptosystems run on actual physical hardware. They're not just abstractions in software. By monitoring the power consumption of a system, watching the timing of the system, how long it takes to perform certain tasks, looking for remnant data on storage mediums which the users thought had been deleted, but in fact still contains clues, remnants of what the data on that medium was. All of these are side-channel attacks, and it's often very surprising what you can learn from a system in unexpected ways. For example, you can statistically analyze how a system uses power when it performs encryption, and then use those statistics to make educated guesses about which keys are being used when a system performs encryption or decryption. So it's another technique that can be used to cut down the key space that has to be searched in a brute force attack. So that's everything we're going to cover about cryptography here. If you'd like a slightly more formal treatment of a lot of the same material, there's a very good video called Applied Cryptography at udacity.com.